spent so many nights thinking how you did me wrong. And I grew strong, and I learned how to get along. And so you're back from outer space. I just walked in to find you here with that sad look upon your face. I should have changed that stupid lock. I should have made you leave your key. If I'd have known for just 1 second you'd be back to bother me. Oh, now go, walk out the door. Just turn around now, 'cause you're not
morning, second service. Hand clap. All right. So good to see you here. I want to start out by saying this is during the first service, somebody said, you know, there's going to be a gift bag. I thought, is this Pastor Appreciation Month? No, that's October. Somebody got you something. I said, okay. So they said, but you got to open it up, you know, right when you get on. I said, okay. And so first I want to tell you, this guy that gave it to me, he got saved about 2 weeks ago after a service. Isn't that awesome? And I thought he was on track for the Lord. I mean, we really prayed, and man, he just was, man, I got to give my life to Christ. It was a beautiful thing. So I got up here, and the gift from him, those that know me know that I rail against two things constantly from the stage, and it's cats and Crocs. He's already off on the wrong foot, no pun intended, giving me Crocs. Come on. So tell me you hate me without telling me you hate me. You know what I'm saying? So, but I am thankful for that, and I appreciate Dustin. Dustin Turner is his name, and he's on fire right now, so I appreciate him doing that. And to be honest, it was the only really lighthearted thing that happened during the last service, because today's a pretty heavy message. I struggled with it, or I felt the intensity of the importance of the message today. So I hope you will too. I hope you'll it would create some tension in you today that it is so important, man. People from the first service, I mean, this was very timely. This is very important. I could tell you that you really put a lot of thought into this, and I appreciate that. So we started this series. It's called Blind Spots, and blind spots can literally mean physically that your eyeball has dark spots in them you can't see. As a matter of fact, I thought it was pretty funny, that I lost my vision last night in my left eye. So I'm only operating 15% here, 85% here, but that is 100%. So I got 100%. So, but I thought, well, how awesome that we're doing blind spots the night before. But blind spots, it can be a physical thing, but most of the time when we use it in our context, it's a metaphor. We're talking about a metaphor. We're talking about blind spots, meaning, hey, there's certain areas that of our life we can't see that well. Maybe other people see it well, but we have a problem recognizing or seeing it. And sometimes things we can't see that are actually there can be damaging to us. Now, we know that in the context of driving. Most people in here drive, and there is a blind spot. We're taught that when we do driver's ed, and we discover it when we think we got it. We've looked beside us, and we give a turn signal, we move over, and there's a car right there. And we try to act like it's their fault. But that's a blind spot. It means I didn't see it, man, and it almost caused some damage to my life. So that's kind of the theme that we've got going on for the next couple of weeks, is these very important things that can be damaging if we don't recognize them, if we don't identify them. So I'm going to be talking about wokeness today. It seems that our culture is really feeding us with a shovel about this idea of wokeness. So I want to kind of, I know that I picked a fight with the enemy on this one. I get that, but it's so important. It keeps me up at night. And I want to talk about theology and Jesus and culture for a little bit today. So I hope you'll lean in as usual, that you'll be taking notes as usual, because this is on your front door. This is on your doorstep in your life, and we have to look at this. And in case you didn't know it, theology is really, really important. Theology. And because the reason it's important is because your lifestyle, the way you live life, the way the decisions you make and the choices you make and the way you live your life is a product of your theology, what you believe about God. And the habits that we have in our life, the way we live life and do, are a product of our doctrine, right? Our understanding of God. That's how we live our life, right? With conviction or without. And so I hear quite a bit, a lot of people say, man, don't worry about theology. Don't worry about doctrine. It's just Jesus loves you, man. Jesus is love. He is love, and he is. He is love, and he is love. But that's only half the story. And so just love Jesus. That's all you got to do. Just love Jesus. And I love that people just say, just love Jesus. But we have to look at theology. And our church is trying to grow, not just in number. I see that you're inviting people and new people every single week, man. Gobs of people visiting and coming. And so now we want to make sure that we're also keeping up with the pace of growing spiritually. So it's important about our theology. And so it's not just Jesus loves you, man. As long as you love Jesus, that's all you need to know. But theology, it creates our lifestyle. It creates our habits. So I want to, as usual, notes will be on the screen. I hope that you'll get them down any way you can. So important. As you mature in your faith, you'll start to realize the importance of taking notes. Because God's going to, if he's giving it to you now, he's going to use it very soon in your life. So it's not like he's withholding. He's passing it out to us, okay? So theology simply means this. It's the study of God. And it's the study of our understanding. It's our understanding of God, okay? It's available to you. It's available to me. Whatever the person that you admire most that has so much knowledge and about God, it's the same information is available to you and to me. So your understanding of God will create your own God. I mean, that's literally the level that you understand God is the level that you apply. And so we got to understand that. And we got to also understand that. And out of that comes our values. You know, what our values are and what our philosophies about life are. What our worldview, and we see things happening in the world. What is the angle that we look at that and apply? How do we respond to those things? So your values and philosophy and worldview, they dictate your decisions and the type of life you live by the little bit of time that we have here on earth, right? So that's why it's extremely important to understand who Jesus is, accurately what it is. Because at this moment, there's so many types of Jesuses out there. Any version you want, you can go online and find. If you're looking for a white Jesus, that you know Jesus is white, that there's a Jesus for that. Black Jesus, Republican Jesus, Democrat Jesus, Black Lives Matter Jesus, all, you know, that whole thing, there's a Jesus out there, every type of Jesus, and you'll find it because everybody's looking for the type of Jesus that fits their life and their view. It's out there. And so we have to know who Jesus really is. This is important to find out who Jesus is. And just as important, who he is not. So I want to talk about being woke. Here's what woke means. Woke means to be awake. It means to be awakened. And it's the ability to increase our awareness. Awareness. And in today's culture, in contemporary culture, it means woke. It means being awakened to and aware of social injustices, which there are. There are some out there. But this turns into, it's not just an awareness. This turns into a passion. This turns into a religion of sorts. So, and there's every type of angle and view and phobia, except Christian phobia. There's no such thing as that. There's all the other phobias. But it's extremely important because I enjoyed reading. I had a sixth grade teacher, who's really taught us at an early age about history. And one of the things was Nazi Germany and all the evils that happened during that time. And I've just started thinking, man, a lot of things, man, that I realized more and more as I get older is that history repeats itself. But not just repeats itself, history rhymes. Okay, and there's certain parallels that I noticed and about being woke and awake. And so being woke means to be awakened by culture instead of being awakened by God. Wow. That's what that means. So to be awakened to the spirit of this world instead of being awakened by the spirit of God. And so speaking of Nazi Germany, you'll notice if you study a little bit about it, I don't know how much history they teach now, but the speeches and all the times that Hitler would talk, it was about an awakening in Germany, okay? An awareness that you're going to see this, they're becoming awakened and they rise. And so he used that, and it was the idea to awaken culture to a particular narrative to people. And that makes me wonder, is wokeness just another idea? Is it just another philosophy, just as innocent as that? Or is wokeness got a demonic spirit attached to it? Does it? Is it just awareness, or is there a particular spirit connected to it? So this is super important, and this could be a blind spot, especially for believers, if we're not careful, a blind spot. Because if we don't see it coming, we don't see what the reality is, it could be damaging to us. And none of us are really immune to that, okay? And the Bible speaks a lot about it. So here's some questions I ask myself. Am I awakened by the Spirit of God, or am I awakened by the spirit of the world? Am I awakened by culture, or am I awakened by God? Which one do I get my thoughts and ideas and my reactivity to? Am I awakened by the gospel of Jesus, or am I awakened by the media? What moves me? What moves me into action? And you know, the Apostle Paul faced these exact same ideas and struggles. And nothing that we face is not have some application from Scripture that's available to us. And Paul had the same things going on. He's writing this book that we're going to, 1 and 2 Timothy, to a guy named Timothy. We're talking about Paul and Timothy. And he's writing a book to him. And he's talking about, Paul's describing end times. And you can argue when end times started and where we are now in that. But all you need to know is that we are in the last days. Okay? And it doesn't just have to be a year or two. It started back then or even before then. But all you need to know is there's a second coming of Jesus. Everything in Scripture is held to be true. And this is what is coming. A second coming of Christ. And we're closer than Paul and Timothy were in their day. So if they were in last days, we're in a double last days, right? So I don't want you to get too hung up on that. But Paul was instructing Timothy on how to live and how to do church and how to do ministry in these last days. It's not going to be easy. There's going to be a lot of pushback. There's a lot of competing thoughts, and he's teaching him how to do it. So in 1 and 2 Timothy, it's all designed for Paul to try to explain for him how to do life. How are you going to live this life following Jesus? What's your church going to look like? What's going to come against the church? How do you do ministry? And what goes into play here in the context of these last days? And he's saying that these last days would be crazy. They're going to be insane. It's going to be nuts. And so we need to know how to maneuver. I firmly believe that the old way of doing church, some of y'all are brand new, man, to Christ, and you just discovered a church, man, and you're getting connected with people, and you like it and love it. There's a church, I'm going to say it's not just cause of COVID or pre-COVID, but it just happens to be COVID is a pretty good marker of, I believe, the way that church has been done, where people just show up and they just count on the pastor to come up with some scripture maybe on a Sunday, and that does you. That's not going to work anymore. That's gone. It's out the door. Everything's on, and that's okay. It's God's timing, and I believe he's building up people to be prepared for the way things are now. So he was saying things are going to get crazy, and you need to know what to look for and how to maneuver and navigate that. So it says here in 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1, it says, now the Holy Spirit tells us clearly that it's the last times, okay? We're in the last times. There's no stuttering. There's no left for interpretation that we are in the last days, and Paul is trying to explain that. And it goes on to say, some will turn away from true faith. It's going to surprise you. It's going to shock you. You thought they had it. They will follow deceptive spirits and teachings that come from demons. There's going to be all kinds of things competing with the gospel and their place on this planet and their assignment on this earth. And you see, behind every teaching, there is a spirit. Behind everyone and behind every worldview and philosophy, there's a spirit attached to it. Okay? But behind anything and everything, there's a spirit. Now, I want you to get this. I want you to write down this word, spiritual discernment. Now, when you come into a relationship with Christ, the Bible says that we have access to the Holy Spirit. It guides our steps. It's a spidey sense. It starts to tell us and how to respond to things, and it helps us most of all to decipher spirits. Okay, you can just tell. Sometimes some of the most I've seen for non-believers is you'll call it intuition. I got a gut feeling. This is beyond that. This is called spiritual discernment, and it comes from knowing Christ, and then we get access to that. But it's the ability to identify a spirit in a person. in an idea, in a church, in a philosophy, where you can tell, man, that is of God or it's not of God. And that's so important. And what I'm so afraid of is people are walking around without spiritual discernment. Okay? That they are, and it's affecting them, and it's a blind spot in their life. They don't realize the importance just yet of having spiritual discernment. Now, some of y'all, the closest I could get to for an example was, we think of COVID. Man, what an awful thing. I don't know. It was just so crazy, and still is. You know, that came about, and what it did to us, and we can feel the spirit that was attached to that. It was a spirit of fear. Who wasn't walking around fearful of themselves and their family, their situation, their jobs? It was a spirit of division in there, right? All of a sudden, it's got people eating at each other, you know, depending on what their thoughts were. And it's full of lies and manipulation across the board. And so there's a spirit attached to that. But man, when you have a relationship with Jesus, man, and you pray for specifically for some discernment, not just pray for it, you go get it. You can detect the spirit because the spirits have characteristics about it that tell you this is not of God. This decision, this job, this person, this church, it's either God or not. But what's interesting is it's about to say is they will follow deceptive spirits. And it says, I'll read it again. It says, now the Holy Spirit tells us clearly that in the last times, some will turn away from the true faith. They will follow deceptive spirits and teachings that come from demons. You see, lies are always deceptive, and they're always seductive. And the thing about Adolf Hitler, how did he get so many people to believe a certain way and get behind it? Man, it's because his lies were seductive. They sounded attractive, right? And the whole point of a lie is to lure you. To lure you in and to lure you to capture you. And it captures your mind, your body, and your spirit. And it deceives you. So make sure you write that down, that lies are deceptive. And they're seductive. And they always look like attraction or emotional manipulation. They grab at your emotions. They grab your attention. They grab your heart. So all of a sudden, then it's competing with God's plan for your life. I told you this was heavy. I'm glad the Crocs were in here, right? That was awesome. This is so important. I'll read it again so you'll get it. Now the Holy Spirit tells us clearly, in the last times that some will turn away from their true faith. They will follow deceptive spirits and teaching that come from demons. So, behind every teaching, behind every leader, behind every idea, behind every philosophy, there is a spirit, and there's a spirit behind everything. Everybody say spirit. But the reality is there's only two spirits. There's no middle ground here. It's binary, to use a current term. It's binary. There's only two. It's either the spirit of God or spirit of the world. It's one of the two. The spirit of the demonic or the spirit of the Holy Spirit. It's either the spirit of Christ or the Antichrist. It's one or the other. There's no middle ground here. And that's why the text was saying that some will follow deceptive spirits and teachings that comes from demons. Demons. Now, this is really massive because Paul's goal was not to really just preach and teach Scripture, but also to defend it. I'm learning that more. Their silence is killing the church. There's so many of the people you like and love, they're inundated. There's a bold effort to change their minds and turn them away from God. And we're sitting there, number one, me, twiddling our thumbs, hoping that they'll go off of what they've learned in the past to bring them back to the Lord. When we're called to be a part of that, to defend, to give a competing, in some cases we're not even competing with that. They're here and inundated. And whatever you hear a lot of, you tend to lean towards it. And so Paul had decided, man, this has got to be defended. Because listen, we have hyper grace in churches, you know. We always say, and it's God is so full of grace. I hope that attracted you. That is one way that God attracts people to him. It's hyper grace and hyper love. Like, man, just love people. If you just love people, that's all you need. You just love. It's true that, man, you love people. That's from knowing God. And out of that, we'll come out with love. And then there's cheap grace, meaning there's no real reason to change. God's grace is so good that there's nothing that you really need to change. Just kind of stay as you are. So although the gospel, man, is so awesome, and that's the part that drew me, was how full of grace that God was. But if we're not careful, we'll try to make the gospel so positive that there's no need for other things. And it's just bring Jesus, man. Jesus loves you, man. That's all you need to know. Just come as you are and just stay as you are. No big deal. That's how good God is. And that means salvation without repentance. And there's no such thing. So here's what I'm learning more and more of, is that the goal of church is not just to preach the truth, but defend the truth. Because there'll always be an increasing amount of deceptive teachings about Jesus. They'll be passionate about it. It'll seem to come from the right place. But it's deceptive. That's why so many people are saying, what the heck's going on in the world? What's going on when I look out there? And they don't understand there's so much seductive teaching. It's so attractive and so sexy. And it's going to capture people's hearts. But behind every teaching, there's a spirit. Behind every philosophy, every worldview, every value, there's a spirit. And as people of God, we don't just want to have the heart of Christ. We want to have the mind of Christ. So that when we look at things and people and situations, we're able to think. We're able to understand. We're able to critique. So I want you to write this down. The kingdom of God is about the will of God and the word of God. That's what the kingdom of God is all about when you whittle it down. Is the will of God and the word of God. That's why, hey, we're going to do on earth as it is in heaven. We're going to build a kingdom here. And that kingdom is the will of God and the word of God. And that's why in these last days, the attack's going to be on those two things. That's what the enemy's coming after. And the world's going to try to manipulate and change it, both of those. The world's going to try to manipulate it and change it and edit it. It's going to look like a counterfeit Christ. And the Bible says we're going to fall for counterfeit churches and a counterfeit gospel. It'll look and feel like God, but it's the opposite of God. That demonic spirit's going to create counterfeits to deceive people, including Christians, people that we love. And the Bible says that they'll leave the true faith. It has the goal of deception, of imitation, to create passion about things that aren't lined up with Scripture. It looks and sounds like it, but it's not. And I found that the enemy's not very creative. He's not that slick. He's pretty slick, but he's not that creative. And what the strategy is just to kind of start with God's Word. That's why it's important, man. Every time, and you're here today, I'm preaching to the choir, although we don't have one. If I turned this way, you'd be in the choir. But you came, man. I want to know what God has for my life. I want to please Him. If there's something going on in my life that ought not to be there, I want to know. And the way we know that is not what the pastor's thoughts are on the topic. It had better be pulled from Scripture, because that's the only truth that there is. And that's what changes us. That's what molds us. That's what makes us move into what God's called us to be. And if that's the case, that's going to be the primary target of the enemy, because he's not that creative. He's going to use God's word. He's going to manipulate it and try to edit it and distort it. Instead of using God's word to change culture, culture is going to be used to change God's word. That's the attempt. There's a few words that are already hit up. One of them is sin. Sin, that's missing the mark. It's an archery term, and it's great. People understood it because it's missing the mark. Hey, this life that God's called me to live, to pursue holiness, the best that I'm able. And with God's help and the Holy Spirit guiding me. But we sin. We're born that way. It's not like you sin eventually and you need a Savior. You're born. The Bible says we're born that way. It's original sin. We're born that way. So we come out of the womb needing a Savior. So hopefully somewhere along the line, somebody presents the gospel to us. They push through all our crap, and they've experienced God's love enough to present it to us so that we can be saved from the penalty of sin. But we all need that. But that word is being canceled. That's not very inclusive, right? That's exclusive to people. And obviously the next word is hell. Hell is the next one. Tough to talk about. I don't like talking about it. Sounds awful. I know I'm not going there, so do I really need to talk about it if I ain't going there? We can get caught up in that. Hell, there can't be a place called hell. God would never send somebody there, but the reality is we send ourselves for having an unrepentant heart, okay? There's always a way out, man. And of course, repentance. That's the newest one. Repentance. That means recognizing, man, acknowledging maybe you never did before. But man, you've noticed that God's starting to speak in your life through his word. So maybe something that the band's singing, man, some words popular got you thinking. Somebody in your life group or in your life, your grandma, and it started to click. You're like, man, this is wrong. This is not how God intended me to live my life. God's got better for me. He's got an assignment. God, I'm going to turn away from that. It's going to be hard, God, because I've been practicing that for a long, long time. I've gotten good at it. But I believe, God, that from your word, you promised you're going to send me help for that. You're going to save me for that. And even if I do fall, God, I've already given my life to you. So repentance is a word that is trying to get canceled. So all this falls under a couple of movements, but one I want to talk about just for a minute or two is progressive Christianity. Most people who consider themselves progressive Christians, most of them won't say it because they know it's wrong. They won't identify that, but some will proudly do it. Progressive Christianity, which I would propose to you is not Christianity at all. Because what they do, they don't view the Word of God as their authority. It's changeable. They think they're smarter than God. They think they're smarter than Jesus. They think they're smarter than Paul. That the Bible needs updated. Because they're part of progressive change, update, evolve. But what we know about God's word is that the Bible is not progressive because it doesn't need to be changed. It's the true word of God. It's infallible. The twist on that is, well, all these sinful people, man made those words. But the Bible says it's inspired by God. I don't know about you, and I'm not pulling my own chain here. I'm just saying I've done good things for God. A few things I've tried to do for God. And it's been awesome to watch and be a part of that. I'm full of sin, absolutely. Why would God work through me to do something that I've got to see and be a part of? Because he's God, and that's what he does. Okay? So if he can do that with somebody as sorry as me, he can do it with people in the Bible. And so anyway, that's the one of the common denominators. They don't view the word of God as the authority. They don't. The rest of it's based on feeling. It's based on new ideas from man. They believe that they're just smarter than God, and they don't speak about hell. They'll speak about heaven. Let's talk about heaven, but not hell. Let's talk about salvation, but not. Let's not talk about sin. We'll leave that part out. And they remove and they add and they edit. At a certain point in their teaching, they know and they start to contradict what the Bible says. And now they're doing it publicly. And the people around us that we like and love and responsible for, the sphere of people that God has put in our path, are sitting ducks for this. Because they hear early and often enough, it seems real. With no competing thoughts because we're sitting silent on the truth. And here's an important question with that in mind. If we're going to talk about heaven, but not hell, salvation, but not sin, is a half-truth true? Is half-gospel, is that gospel? I think those are good questions, and this has to be addressed and be dealt with because people are going to hell. I hate that. I hate it, but it's what motivates me every day. Is that maybe our small little spot on the corner here in West Gastonia that somebody would find hope and help and they would be saved. There's an urgency attached to it and it has to be addressed. And nobody's telling them that the gospel is not just for comfort, but it's actually to convict. I want to talk about that for a minute. So write this down. The gospel isn't just for comfort for you, but also it's to convict you. I love it that you're comforted, man. There's no other comfort available to you than what comes from Scripture. But just like God's word is so dynamic, it can comfort you and convict you. But sometimes we leave that part out. I want you to leave inspired every time. Man, I'm going to do what God's called me to do, man. I just heard that it was affirmed by what we sang about, man. The people around just encouraged me. I'm going out and do what God. I want you to feel encouraged and inspired. But I also want you to understand that with Scripture, that's the authority of a believer. And although, yeah, you get comfort, you also get convicted. That's a part of it. We need to normalize that. So it's not just to comfort you, but to convict you. And not just to inspire you, but to rebuke you. Rebuke just means a harsh and sharp disapproval. Like, man, what you're doing is wrong. I'm not going to say it in public. I'm going to get that speck out of my eye to the best that I can. But we've got to be willing to say with the people we love, not just walking up to strangers and giving them over the head about things, but we withhold it. And I know why you do it. I know why you do it, because you love them. You're hoping that they turn a corner and that you can still preserve the relationship. I know why you do it. But the Bible says, now listen, I've got the best plan for your life and everybody around you, and I've given you something called truth. Don't withhold it, because that's the opposite of love, is to withhold it. Am I making sense? Y'all with me? So the Holy Spirit, man, it will convict you. A lot of times before it comforts you. And the Bible will convict you a lot of times before it inspires you. That's why there's no real change in some people, because they only get half truth. They're inspired and encouraged, but they're not convicted and corrected. And that's why some people, you see them kind of not really moving forward. It's because they only got half of it. So we can't edit God's word. We can't just pick and choose what's convenient for our lifestyle and create a Jesus that doesn't even exist. Because God called the church to change the world and not to be changed by the world. So write this down. Conviction is the only pathway to authentic conversion. You can't have a conversion. You can't step into a belief in God without that conviction, saying, God, the way I've lived my life is wrong. I'm not even embarrassed about it, God. I just want you to change. I'm just glad. I don't care who knows. I'm just glad to walk away from this life the way I've been living it and into what you've called me to do. The goal is the truth, is to for you to become either repentant or offended. So I want you to write this down. You have two choices when you hear the gospel. When you hear God's word presented to you, whether it's from a stage, from a life group, or personal and in interpersonal relationships, you've got a choice to either be offended or repentant. What does it do when you think about that, man? God, what? Right this minute. Are you repentant of it? Man, this is God's word. I'm sorry, God. I just didn't get it until now. Or are you offended? Are you offended? Because the proof of the gospel is either repentance. If it's being taught, it's either going to create repentance or offense. Really want you to get this. The gospel is not come as you are and stay as you are. A lot of times we get hung up, man, and who hadn't been guilty of this? You want as many people in the church as possible with good intentions. I want to be packed out. I want people sitting in the floor Indian style. You know, I want all of that. Because in my mind, I really think that, well, the more people in here, more chance somebody's going to be saved, man, really. And we can become, it kind of just whittles away and it's subtle. And we can almost, even inadvertently sometimes, think, man, as long as you come here, you're great. You're good. You made it. You made it. But I want this, God wants this, is to us to create a culture at this church. I don't know what everybody else is doing. There's great churches, man, around. If you could throw a rock and hit an awesome church, I'm so glad that you came here. But we have to create an environment where, man, we're expected to change. That's exactly what God does. That's proof that he's moving, right? To sit and stay the same for weeks and months and years and decades. It's not one. We can lull people into a false sense of security, thinking that just because they came to church and they feel comfortable here. God said, man, God didn't bring you here to stay the same. He came here to change you and to change me. And I hear people all the time say, man, I'm on this journey, man, with God, and I'm just walking this journey. Man, I've decided with that, man, that can't cut it. There's urgency. We can't wait on you to figure it out. Man, as soon as you come into a relationship with Christ, it's time. There's urgency because people, man, they're going to hell. They need to repent, and there's an urgency. We don't have time for you to walk on some journey to get God all figured out. There's an urgency now. And the Bible's very clear that Jesus is coming back. And before he does, there's this all-out assault on them to distract them from what God's called them to. So theology and doctrine, man, are so important, man. It dictates how you live this life, decisions you make, how you view things. And here's what Paul says about the Bible. Here's what he says. It's in 1 Timothy 3:16. It says, all scripture, if you're wondering, is this just something that some man wrote? All scripture is inspired by God and beneficial for teaching, for rebuke, for correction, and for training in righteousness. Righteousness just means doing the very best you can to follow God, to be as blameless as you can. That is a journey to constantly, man, there's things that we're walking away from and throwing off of ourselves, addictions that we have to overcome, habits that we have to break. God's going to give us the power to do that, right? But that's what the Bible, that's a whole list of things that the Bible does and is good for. So why in the world? I know that some of you don't read your Bible. It's not because you can't read. Because I remember the first book I had, Sun Up, Sun Down, in the first grade. There's maybe one sentence on each page. But my first grade teacher, Miss Barnwell, taught me to read. So I know how to read, and probably 99% of you know how to read. And I'm not making fun of those that don't. There is a literacy. So it's not a matter of you not knowing how to read. Are you craving God's word? Is this something you got to go after? You have to go and get it. I was in school was hard for me. I got by in high school. It wasn't a big deal, but enough to play sports. Anybody like that? What kind of grades you make? A's, B's, C's? I said, as long as I could play sports. That was my standard. I guess, everybody looks back and says, I could have done better. I should have done better. I would have done better. I got to college, man, things got a little bit more tougher to absorb it at that point because I hadn't been giving it my all before. So here it is, and I started thinking, man, one day I'm going to get married, and I'm going to need to be good at whatever it is I do, and I'm not feeling confident. And when I got to graduate school, man, you're talking about everybody in there smart, and I felt like the dumbest one in the whole university. And so I kept my advisor's door. I mean, I just almost beat a hole in it. Hey, I didn't really understand what we talked about today. I got to be honest. Can you explain this to me? I just didn't get this. And he's like, hey, yeah, man, I'm glad you came. A lot of people, they don't come. And they wind up getting a bad grade or dropping out or feeling insecure by the time they graduate. They just don't get it. So I kept his door hot constantly. Hey, can you explain this to me? Right? Because there's a big responsibility waiting for me in this life. At this point, I've got a lot of people counting on me to know what I know. And I don't feel like I know that sometimes. But I had to go get it. And that's the way God's word is. Is some of you, it's not that you don't know how to read. We got to create urgency and a craving for God's word. And you got to go get it. Stop waiting on somebody to put it on your lap. Go get it. Some of y'all good at going to get. There's business people in here. You go get it. You get what you need. And get what you want. And I want to just say that that's the importance of Scripture. And Paul's sitting here saying that all of this, man, it's good for, it's beneficial for teaching and for rebuke. Man, you need God's word. It's for correction. While you're being inspired and you're learning things, you also be corrected. And it's training for righteousness. It makes you grow closer in your walk with Christ. Verse 17 says, hey, do this so that the man or woman of God may be fully capable and equipped for every good work. God's got something awesome for you, and it's probably outside of your comfort zone in a lot of ways, but there's something dynamic about Scripture that prepares you for that. It just said the word equipped. It prepares you for it. It gives you what you need to do very good work. So 2 Timothy goes on about this, 2 Timothy 4, verse 2. So preach the word of God. Be prepared whether the time is favorable or not. Whether it's favorable or not, and patiently correct and rebuke. That means give sharp disapproval. and encourage your people with good teaching. That's God's word. And for the time is coming where when people will no longer listen to sound and wholesome teaching. They will follow their own desires and will look for teachers and ideas who will tell them whatever their itching ears want to hear. And then, therefore, they will reject the truth and chase after myths. So progressive Christianity, that whole idea, whether they name it or not, it changes the word of God to fit their world instead of changing their world to fit God's word. And it's always, progressive Christianity is always on the side of culture. Every single time, because they're led by the spirit of the world. So you're going to need discernment in your life. And how do you get that? You get it from God's word. When I see people, they're wanting to lead a life group or they're wanting to do something. And one thing I look at, I think that just a leader should, is how's their discernment? Are they absorbing God's word where something comes along that they can decipher, this is not from God. This is not, I don't feel that. The Holy Spirit telling me that this is good. We need that as believers. You need it. You need it for you. You need it for this church. You need it for your family. You need it for your children. You need discernment. Some of you are walking around here, man, without that discernment. And it's available to you, though, through God's word and studying, obeying his word. And I believe if we do this, man, if we start to become unsilent about the truth, I believe that we could shift culture. I think it's not too late for more people to have an opportunity to be saved and do amazing work before they go to heaven. But, and write this down, to speak truth, to give people that truth, to speak truth, you have to know truth. You got to go get it. You got to crave it. It just said, when it's difficult, it seems hard right now to push through that. If we're going to get people out of bondage, and that's what we call that. They're in bondage to these ideas and these thoughts. They can't get out. It's like somebody in prison. They can't get out. They need somebody to come and get them out. And we do that with truth. The truth of the gospel, the truth of the Bible is the authority in a believer's life. It's the authority. Now listen, culture's not going to like that. I'm glad I think about this quite a lot. I've said this before, man. I'm not going to say popular. I'm not going to say that because that sounds conceited. I liked a lot of people and a lot of people liked me. Not everybody, I'm sure. But I got along with everybody. I like to be liked. I can't fathom somebody. I don't like it when somebody doesn't like me. But man, the more you are dedicated in ministry, there's people that will not like you only because of their disobedience to God and where they are. I've had to learn it's very, very difficult. This is not a popular notion. This is picking a fight. It's run up to the biggest bully in the playground and punching them in the nose to tell people truth and give them something, but it will save their life. Maybe they'll grab a hold of it. Maybe they won't. Maybe they'll realize it later and be so thankful about it. Maybe never. It's not just my assignment as the pastor of this church. That's not my assignment. Not just mine. It's yours too. This life you're living, the people that God's put around you, he wants you to know truth. Go get it. He'll give it to you. He'll give discernment to help you along the way. And we're breaking people out of jail. We're helping people that are blind. Man, I went. Sorry. I think it was a biscuit I ate earlier. For 12 days, I was blind, man. Back in, Christmas and New Year's is horrible. I mean, I had to put my fingers in my food to see what I was eating. I had to have Holly tell me what it was. This short of spoon feeding me. And I needed her. I couldn't see it for myself. I needed her to say, this is what you're eating. This is where it is. Watch out for that step. Here, let me be with you. Let me guide you. Take my arm. And that's what people that are spiritually blind need. They need that much help. They can't see it for themselves. They're blind spiritually. And they need us to be that involved. They can't see it for themselves. So I want to ask you, man, to pray for boldness, to pray for whatever that is. Is it courage? Is it stamina? What is it that you need? Would you pray for it? I mean, would you dare to pray for something like that? God's got such an assignment for the people of this church. So I just want to say that, man, culture's not going to like it. It hates truth. But we're living in a time, this time, on purpose. I want to go back to that scripture, Psalm 146, verse 8. Let's read that again. With what we have now, knowing what we just read, and we'll end on this. It'll be your chance to respond. Psalm 146, verse 8. It says, the Lord gives sight to the blind. That's very hopeful. That means people that are blind because they were born that way, just never knew God, spiritually speaking. They never knew God. They're blind spiritually. Or something happened to them, like me. Like, I could see before, but now I can't. Something happened along the line where I can't see now. Either way, Scripture says that Lord gives sight to the blind, so there's hope for them. This is not like they're the enemy. These are people that have bought into a lie. But God says that he will give sight to them. So we need to pray for them. We need to give them truth and be patient with them and love them. That's good news, that the Lord's willing to give sight to the blind. The next part says the Lord lifts up those who are bowed down. It's talking about your posture. Would you change your posture today about, man, I never gave God's word the full authority in my life. I've read a couple parts of it. I get tired and yawn, and I do it right before bed, so I just fall asleep, or it's been a while. I've been busy with this or that. But what if you were thinking along this line, you have been deceived, and you're seeing that God's revealing to you that you are? Would your posture change there about it too? Because the Bible says, man, if you bow down, that's a sign of humbleness. It's a sign of posture that the Lord will lift you up. So he doesn't leave you there. He doesn't leave us being biblically illiterate. He doesn't leave us buying into another idea and philosophy. He's willing to lift us up out of that. And the last one is the Lord loves the righteous. So he gives and he lifts and he loves. He loves the righteous. Righteous is somebody's trying to, hey, I'm trying to adhere to God's teaching. It's not necessarily how I live my life, but I'm seeing where God has intended for me, and I'm going to pursue that the best that I'm able. I'm going to surround myself with people. I'm going to get into a church that is the scriptures, the authority, and the people seem willing to get down and dirty with me. And I'm pursue God, and I'm going to get to the next level where I'm helping people with what I went through. And I'm pursuing God with everything I'm able to. He's not calling for perfection, but he is calling for holiness. That's what God offers to you today and every day. So listen, this was heavy. This is very thick. But I think it's timely. I think it's important as a church moving forward to doing what God's called us to do and reaching people that God's called us to reach, that we get this. I would love to go back over it with you privately. If you've got questions, like, Richard, I got 1,000 questions. All right, let me clear my schedule. There's ways to gobble up God's word. You know what I'm saying? I hope it becomes insatiable, that you just learn it and keep wanting more. That's why there's no shortage at this church. We meet every Sunday. I mean, the government literally has to tell us to close down. They did, like COVID, like you can't meet. Okay? Otherwise, we're here. Or some kind of blizzard, maybe. But God's word is available for you to learn. Sundays is awesome. Glad you're here. We're called, Jesus died on the cross so to save us of our sins and so we can meet like this. So thank you for not neglecting that. But we have life groups as well. It's another opportunity to come around with other broken, messed up people just like you, to come along with all their backgrounds and things, but the common things that unifies them, which gives glory to God when you're unified. And learn about what God says about our life, and just the whole that whole hour, you're just lining your life up with it, despite who's around you, or because of who's around you, right? So I want to end with this, is that's the opportunity for you to respond. Please, God, don't make it another Sunday where you're not responding in your head, in your heart. What about that posture part, man? Does it help you like it does me to say, man, sometimes I just have to kneel. I want something about maybe coming to the altar to present God with something. It's got nothing to do. It's not a show. It's I have to position myself in a humble position to show God that I'm coming to Him. He's King. He's the authority. And whatever it is that's in your life that you're repenting of, maybe you're coming down here to pray for somebody else. It's not even you this time. It's like, God, thank you for doing what you're doing in my life. I want to pray for my neighbor. I want to pray for my friend. There's health issues. There's spiritual issues, emotional issues. Submit it to God.